Henderson Planning Commission, September 14th. Please silence your cell phones so that we're not hearing your conversations. And if you have conversations with other people in the audience, please take it outside. And welcome. I'd like to go ahead and call this evening's meeting of the Planning Commission to order. Before we begin, please note that this meeting is being video recorded and streamed live to the internet. May I have a confirmation of posting and roll call?
Chair Lewis, the agenda has been posted according to the Nevada Open Meeting Law. All commissioners are present except Commissioners Andoja and Bokelman, who are excused.
Thank you. Will everyone please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Staff, are there any changes to the agenda?
Yes, the following changes have been included in the backup documentation. For item number 9, the development agreement for Lakemore, there was a last-minute revision to the development agreement that was added to the backup this afternoon, and a comparison document was also added to the backup that shows a change made to section 11.5, the permitted transfer section. The revision clarifies that if the master developer transfers any portion of the property to a joint venture or a partnership before the tailings remediation is complete, the master developer must retain no less than 50% of voting interest in the joint venture or partnership. Item number 17 for Serene Country Estates, the Sandstone St. Rose Park, a memo has been provided adding findings of fact to staff's recommendation on page 10 of the staff report. And on item number 19, Casa del Sol Land Use and Zoning, the wrong neighborhood meeting notice was uploaded online. Online to the backup documentation has been replaced online with a correct notice. And there's also been the following item has been requested for continuance. Staff recommends continuance as noted for item number 6 for Inspirata Station. As noted on the agenda, this item has been continued to the November 16, 2023 Planning Commission meeting.
Thank you. Based on the recommendation of staff, in accordance with Planning Commission policy, it is the intention of the Planning Commission to make a motion to continue items as noted. For those of you who are unable to attend the meeting for which the item has been continued, please submit your written comments to Community Development and Services. Is there a motion to accept the agenda? All right, there's a motion on the floor. Please vote. And that motion passes. All right. This brings us to the consent portion of the agenda, consisting of items 1 through 4. Is there anyone here who wishes to discuss anything on the consent agenda? Doesn't sound too good. May we have a motion on the consent agenda?
I'll move for approval of the consent agenda items.
All right, please vote. There's a motion for approval on items 1 through 4. And that motion passes. Staff, may we hear the first item, please?
Thank you. Item number 5 is for Sonoran Bluff Addition. The applicant is requesting to reduce the rear yard setback from 15 feet to 10 feet, located at 1698 Sonoran Bluff Avenue. The subject addition will enclose the existing patio cover and be adjacent to the Whitney Mesa Recreation Open Space Area. The applicant has provided compensating benefits for this request, including reduced height of the structure as well as enhanced architecture that is compatible with the existing residence. Staff notes that this item was continued from the August 10th Planning Commission meeting. Staff recommends approval of this request.
Thank you. For people who are new here, typically we'll ask our applicant for their name and zip code for the record, and then they'll present. So, applicant, may we have your name and zip code for the record?
Yes, my name is Richard Otsubo. I am the owner of 1698 Sonoran Bluff Avenue in Henderson. And my zip code is 89014. The house is built by D.H. Horton, and we have a patio in the backyard, which is 10 feet away from the property line. And the property line, there is a block wall. Beyond that block wall, there is a huge storm drain. There's also a driveway where the maintenance people use, and the public use that for a walkway during the morning and evening. Beyond that, there is a cliff about 500 or 600 feet away, and there's a lot of wildlife vegetation, and it's very interesting.
Okay.
The purpose of my applying for this waiver is to enclose that patio. The roof is there. All we have to do is build three walls, add more windows to the back so we can see what we can see in the backyard. The waiver, it's kind of expensive, but I think it's a good money that we gonna use it for. We like to enclose portion of the patio. The roof is there. All we have to do is add three walls, and we're asking for your help.
Thank you. Did you have a chance to read staff's recommendation, the staff report? I'm sure staff sent you a report with the conditions of approval. Maybe not. One second.
You read the staff report, right? It was the conditions. Do you concur with the conditions?
Commissioner, do you mind if I mention something?
Yes. Do you agree with that?
Mind if I mention something real quick?
Oh, for sure.
So I just want to let you know the conditions are our standard conditions. There are nothing specific that are unusual or would have restricted this other than the waiver he's requesting.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. All right. Do you have anything else? Are you good? Why don't we see if any of your
neighbors... I can't hear.
Oh, no, I have a mumbling voice. Why don't we go ahead and see if any of the neighbors are in the audience and want to discuss it. So go ahead and open the public hearing. Is there anyone who wishes to speak on this item? Seeing none, we'll go ahead and close the public hearing. Commissioners?
I'll make a motion to approve WOS 2023-01-29464, subject to findings of fact and a condition and a waiver.
And there's a motion on the floor. Please vote. And that application has been approved. Thank you for coming in to see us. You've been approved. You're good to go.
All right. Moving forward, item number 6 has been continued. Item number 7 is for Journey Church. This is a request for a religious assembly use located at 10 and 12 Commerce Drive, Building D. The applicant has demonstrated that adequate parking for the proposed use is provided through a shared parking agreement with an adjacent property. The request is compatible with adjacent uses and complies with all standards for a religious assembly use. Staff recommends approval of this request.
Good afternoon. Name and zip code for the record, please.
Good afternoon. 89123. Randy Barnes, RBA Architecture, representing the applicant. And we're happy to, we've reviewed staff's conditions, we're in compliance, and we're happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. I will go ahead and open the public hearing. Is there anyone here who wishes to speak on this item? Seeing none, we'll go ahead and close the public hearing. Commissioners?
Questions?
Questions, comments, concerns?
I'll make a motion to approve CUP 202-301-2330, subject to findings of facts and conditions.
And there's a motion on the floor. Please vote. All right, the motion passes. May we hear the next item, please?
Item number 8 is for Lakemoor. This is a petition to vacate a portion of a government right-of-way grant and public road easement generally located southwest of the intersection of Lake Las Vegas Parkway and Lake Mead Parkway. Staff recommends approval of this request as it is aligned with the proposed development at this location. This item will be scheduled for the October 3rd City Council meeting.
All right, and we have a disclosure from Commissioner Rice.
I represent Lakemoor Development LLC and Lakemoor Ventures LLC, the applicants on this item and on item 9. I have performed substantial legal work on these applications and on the Lakemoor project. Therefore, my judgment in this matter would be materially affected by my commitment in my private capacity to the interests of these clients and my law firm. Consequently, I have been advised by counsel that I should make this disclosure pursuant to the Nevada ethics laws and that I should abstain from deliberation and voting on this item as well as item 9, both of which pertain to the Lakemoor project.
Thank you. Applicants, name and zip code for the record, please.
Thank you, Madam Chair, Commissioners. Tom Amick, 1980 Festival Plaza. I'm here on behalf of the applicant tonight, which is Lakemoor Ventures and Pulte. Also with me is Mr. Marciano, 218 Ledge Street. Andy Barron, who will be speaking a little bit after me. He can give his address when he comes up. And then also just wanted to introduce Shane Markison from Pulte Home and Mindy Unger-Watkins here from the Lakemoor Venture. So I'm going to give just a quick overview of kind of what we have here tonight. And then I'll let Andy kind of run through a very quick PowerPoint that has some details of the project. So we're here. This is a long time coming for us and for the city. This is a process that started 16-ish or so years ago to try to get the Three Kids Mine cleaned up and ultimately developed. And really, that's what we're here now. We have kind of the culmination of those efforts with the federal government, with the state of Nevada and the Department of Environmental Protection, and with you as the city and your redevelopment agency as our partner in this. So what you have here tonight, before you tonight, is which would be under the Planning Commission's purview. Oh.
Would you mind maybe redirecting and we'll just deal with your
vacation first?
I think we should do the vacation first, but okay. And we appreciate the long introduction for that vacation.
That saves me. It saves me.
All right. Well, let's talk about the vacation.
So the vacation is just a vacation of some government rights of way. There's some road easements that we're vacating along Lake Mead that, as a result of the project I'm about to tell you about, we no longer need those easements. So that's what the vacation is for. So if you guys want to act on that first, that's great. If you want to hold it and hear the other one first, we could do that too.
Get a sense staff would like it most if we acted on the vacation and then dealt with the land use application, the development agreement secondary.
Yeah, that would be ideal. Yep.
As I said. I'll go ahead and open the public hearing. Is there anyone here who wishes to speak on the vacation at Lakemoor? Seeing none, we'll go ahead and close that public hearing and see if anyone has any questions from the commission.
Seeing no questions, I'll make approval for VAC 20220118 69, subject to a finding of fact and a condition.
There's a motion on the floor for the vacation. Please vote. And that motion passes. Now you Thank can you. Go into your much longer stuff. Do you need to introduce this one?
Yes. Item number 9 is also for Lakemoor. This is a three-part request for a new residential planned community on 1,148.3 acres, generally located south of the intersection of Lake Mead Parkway and Lake Las Vegas Parkway. Staff notes this is the site of the former Three Kids Mine, which originally operated as an open pit manganese mine. The first part of the request includes a negotiated development agreement between the City of Henderson and Lakemoor Ventures LLC. The development agreement encompasses a maximum of 3,000 residential units, 900 of which are planned as age-restricted, and includes development standards for proposed development within the community. The development agreement also addresses remediating the existing open pit mine site while protecting the city from environmental and development risks. The second part is a rezoning of 1,026 acres, which includes changes from development holding and public/semi-public zoning districts and gaming with gaming and hillside overlays to a planned community zoning district with hillside and redevelopment overlays. The third part of the request includes a 19-lot parent tentative map. The map consists of 12 parent and 7 remnant lots for future residential development, park sites, and 2 parcels north of Lake Mead Parkway for uses that have yet to be determined. The map also establishes 7 remnant parcels that will prohibit development for hillside and undisturbed areas. The applicant has conducted extensive environmental assessments to recognize environmental conditions at the site and has worked with the city to establish terms for a process and framework for the remediation, reclamation, and ultimately development of the site as outlined in the proposed development standards. The applicant has demonstrated that the proposal complies with all approval criteria and code requirements. Staff recommends approval of this request. This item will be scheduled for the October 3rd City Council meeting.
Thank you. Applicant, name and zip code for the record.
Thank you, Madam Chair, Commissioners. Tom Amick, 1980 Festival Plaza. Sorry for jumping the gun there. That would have probably been better for Erica to have done that first. But again, John Marciano, 218 Ledge Street. Also with us tonight is Andy Barron from Oblaw down in Arizona, Mindy Enigo Watkins from Lakemoor Ventures, and Shane Markinson from Pulte. So, based on Erica's synopsis there, we're here tonight to present the ultimate development plan for what we refer to as the Lakemoor community, the former Three Kids Mine site. This is a culmination of a lot of years, plural, of work. Negotiations started on this site some 16 years ago. It's a collaborative effort between the federal government and the state of Nevada through the Department of Environmental Protection and from the city of Henderson, all with the goal of getting the mine cleaned up, making it safe for development, and then ultimately the project that you will see before you that Pulte will develop. That would come on the backside of the remediation of the mine being completed. So that's what we're here for. So tonight, you guys are hearing the development agreement and the zoning applications that are associated with the project that would ultimately be constructed once the remediation and the cleanup is complete. That is a process that will be overseen and supervised by NDEP in terms of ultimately or initially cleaning up the site as it exists today. And then once that happens, then the project that Andy will walk you through would be what would come on the footsteps of that. So I'm gonna let, we're happy to answer any questions that either the audience or that you guys might have. While the remediation and the environmental stuff isn't necessarily what's before the Planning Commission, we understand that it's part and parcel of the project as a whole. So if there are questions relating to the cleanup or anything involving the remediation, we're happy to address those. But I think to start, I'll bring Andy up. We'll let him walk you guys through the project, and then we can take any questions from you guys if you have them.
Thank you.
Good evening, Chair, Commissioners. My name is Andy Barron, President of ABLA, I'm a land planner and landscape architect. Here on behalf of the applicant this evening.
And what's your zip code?
I was just going to get to that. 85281, Tempe, Arizona.
Thank you.
So this, as Tom had said, we've been working on this for quite some time, so we're very excited to be here this evening, and I'm excited to be part of another really amazing master plan community within Henderson. So I think I've done three now. So I want to walk through a presentation. Do I just click this, or do I have to start it? Let's see if it goes.
Audience view. Click the left, then click audience view.
Want me to show you?
Do you know how to do it, John?
Yeah, sure.
Oh. I don't see it on the screen yet.
It's on the laptop, it's on the but laptop. It's not on it's extended not on view, Andy.
Gypsy operation.
Okay, some technical difficulties. The advantage is you all have a hard copy, but the public does not. So, mm-hmm. Some Jeopardy music we can play, or. I can do that. It's fine.
Sure, we'll go through the hard copies.
You guys do an overhead camera?
We're going to use the hard copies
right now. Oh, wait.
There it goes.
He's doing something magical.
Got it. It was on extended view.
My mouse is running all over the screen.
There's a game.
We'll start with this.
We'll do the hard copies.
Man. Yeah, it's not a problem.
Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it, man. We're good.
Yeah.
Just tell them we're going to.
It works.
It's okay. So I can recover. Now we're going to wait for the camera.
Oh, the public still can't see it.
Oh, okay.
All right. Okay. I'm assuming that that's on these screens now. All right. Okay. So as we said, we have been working for quite some time on this and very closely with staff. And the result of that is this document that I'm sure you've all read word for word, looked at every image. Essentially, what we've done is we started a formal application for development agreement, zoning, and parent tentative map, and that was filed toward the end of 2022. During that time, although this document shows that we had a neighborhood meeting, there were numerous public outreach opportunities, but the required neighborhood meeting is what's documented here. So the site located south of the Lake Las Vegas master plan community, west of Lake Mead, obviously sort of sandwiched up against the mountain range here on the south. And the red outline is the property itself, which is generally about 1,000 plus acres of potential development. Get some of the existing land use out of the way. The existing comprehensive plan today shows it as a planned community, which we're obviously in conformance with, no changes there. The existing zoning today is sort of split. We have development holding and then a no zoning property, kind of a third of the property is development holdings, the remainder is no zoning. I think it was mentioned as Erica was reading through the proposed zoning, we are proposing a planned community. Obviously, the result of that is these development standards, development agreement, park agreement, OPA. The portion that's in purple on here is the hillside area. We'll talk about that a little bit more as we get into it. That area basically is going to be preserved, undeveloped, natural terrain. What you're looking at here is the proposed master plan. What we've essentially done here is divided it into 8 different development areas. Each of those development areas is allocated a certain number of units, and the product types are defined within this document, and any development standards associated with a specific product type would follow what we've agreed to with staff and those development standards themselves. Working kind of plan left to right is development area 1, and then sequence sort of counterclockwise that goes up to the development area 8, which is the small pink parcel across the street on Lake Mead Parkway. That particular parcel, development unit 8, does not have any established uses on it today. If it were to be developed, it would actually come back through commission and council for whatever that use would be determined at that time. So there are no units assigned to it. It's not planned for any commercial uses at this time. That would be a future application. Of that land area, essentially the colors that are red, purple, blue, orange, yellow, kind of a darker blue and the brown, we have a total of 3,000 units that we're planning to develop. Of that, up to 900 units could be utilized as an age-restricted community. So that could potentially develop in, well, it is planned in development area 2. It could extend to development area 3 and development area 6. And that is at the option of Pulte. So I have a chart in here that will have a little bit more detailed information. We don't need to go through the numbers, but we've worked exhaustively with staff to establish criteria for density transfer. That allows us to respond to market and provide product specific to what Pulte wants to develop. And at the same time, it also, very similar model that we've done at Black Mountain and what we've done at Inspirata, it really restricts anybody from transferring a bunch of density into one location and doing what we've called the density dump in the past. And it's just not possible the way that this is set up. So these numbers and the criteria, there's a series of forms and applications that have to occur within the development standards to file any transfers. And then those materials will be provided to staff as well at the same time with the application. This plan shows primary circulation for the project. Obviously, the Lake Mead Parkway is the primary arterial leading up to it. There are 3 connections that I'll use my pen to kind of point out because we're not on a screen. West Road, Center Road, and East Road. Following this, I'll show you some cross-sections of each as well. And then the primary east-west transportation corridor within the project is ironically called East-West Parkway at the moment. I'm sure it'll get something a little bit better down the road, but for now that works. What we're doing, and I'm going to jump into the cross sections here, the 2 roads, which would be West Road and Center Road, have 4-lane collectors with a divided parkway, so it has a raised median. There is an expansive landscape parkway there as well. The site, if anybody has been out there, there is a fair amount of topography, so we are dealing with conditions where, as Tom had mentioned, through the remediation process, you know, we're covering some of the property, so there will be some soil that is built up in areas. In doing that, we are dealing with that with some of our landscape parkways. You'll see some walls and things of that nature within this document that allow us to mitigate some of those height conditions. As we look a little bit further to the east, we have the East Parkway, which is a 2-lane collector with a bike lane and separated landscape. Sidewalk and landscape behind the sidewalk. And then the last section that I've got in here, which starts to show some of the topography that we're dealing with, is the East-West Parkway, which is a 2-lane collector with a striped median, and then an expanded landscape parkway with some terracing. Now, terracing would occur on the south side as we're kind of going up in terrain. Parks and open space, as with any master plan within Henderson, this project is providing in parks pursuant to the Parks and Recreation Department requirements. So we have worked very closely with them. One of the differences on this particular project than some other master plans is these parks will be privately owned and maintained by the HOA. We have coordinated with Parks and Rec on that specifically. There is a small relocation of the, well, actually it's not a relocation, of the trail that runs on Leakley Parkway, and I think that shows on the next sheet, so I'll touch that there. Essentially, there's three major parks in the project, what we call Fondly Park A, which I have an exhibit for, we'll show you shortly. Park B, so Park A is 5.5 acres, Park B is 3 acres, and then Park C, the community park, is 14.14 acres. Each of these parks is connected through a trail corridor that's on the East-West Parkway. In that street section, you probably saw that there was an expanded space with the terracing of the rockery walls. That is where the trail would go, and that provides connectivity throughout the community. And then on the next sheet, I'll show you some trail corridors that we're also planning. Essentially, 39.6 acres of park required. In total, we're providing 42.27 acres of park and trails, and what we're calling HOA trails. Additionally to that, the green area that's on this particular map is also showing a large portion of preserved property. I think it's really important for us to point out that when we combine the parks that we're dedicating, the HOA trails, the trails themselves, and the preserved land, it's generally 28% of the overall project area, which is very substantial. So a lot of this project is going to remain as open space. This is our trails and circulation map. Each one of these trails represents a different type. Primarily, the East-West Parkway Trail, that is the one that will be generally amenitized. We've negotiated that with parks, and that's in our parks agreement. The trails that work around the perimeter, those would be our HOA trails. Opportunities for us to be able to connect the communities within to those trails will occur as we're doing the site planning processes. Additionally, any access that we can get to the East-West Parkway, again, understanding that there's great separation there, will be worked through in a planning exercise. And the River Mountain Trail Loop is what I was mentioning before, and I didn't do a good job of explaining that, but this black dashed line represents the existing alignment. What we want to try to point out there is that we're not messing with that at all. It's staying in place, that it's not something that we're modifying, that it does have adjacency to some open space with our Park A, and there may be some connections that benefit from us doing development here and expanding some recreation opportunities. I should point out, and I didn't mention this, that the parks within the project will have public access easements over them. So while the HOA is privately maintaining them and they will be privately constructed, they still will be of use for the public. And that's in the park agreement, which I don't know that you guys have seen. Some blow-up exhibits of the parks themselves, fairly simple labeling here, but again, programming that we've extensively negotiated with Parks and Rec. So you'll see that there's a series of kids' play areas. This is the Park A on the far west side of the project, 5.5 acres. Some courts, some picnic areas, shaded Ramada spaces. Again, nice activity. Park B, which is in the center of the project, that comes generally right off of West Parkway, pickleball courts. Above that, you know, sort of planned bottom here on the bottom of this would be the active adult community that, Pulte will be developing, as well as an event lawn, some parking spaces, some kids play, a restroom facility, etc. And then finally, Park C, which is the largest park. This has multi-purpose fields in it, pickleball, splash pad, more kids play areas, some garden space, volleyball, some pretty hefty programming. Again, all things that we've worked very closely with the folks within Parks and Rec. So with that, I will end and be happy to answer any questions.
Would there be a possibility of the owners putting in, this is not a condition of approval, but would there be a possibility of them putting in some type of a monument, possibly parks A, B, and C, would be great locations as a suggestion to honor the war and city of Henderson and the people that died in that war?
Yeah, thank you, Commissioner. That, I did discuss that with both Mindy and Shane in terms of trying to figure out the best way to memorialize the Three Kids Mine and the World War II effort in general that the city of Henderson was involved in. So we're gonna look at some options. It might be something within the parks. We're also looking at the HOA trails that Andy had mentioned in terms of doing some kind of monumentation along the trail corridor, so that you're kind of doing something maybe chronologically. But we recognize the, you know, that that's part of the city's history, and that the you know the impact that that mine in particular had for the city. So we will do something, but the details of that yet, we just don't have it sorted out. So,
Thank you. That's wonderful that you guys are going to do this, for considering it, and thank you.
All right.
Got it.
Are you guys finished with your presentation so I can open the public meeting, or do you have more?
I don't think so, unless you guys have questions for us. But
it's going to actually try to open the meeting to public, to our audience, and then maybe bring it back to the commissioners.
Sure.
If that's all right. Is there anyone in the audience who wishes to speak on this item? Come on down. Name and zip for the record, please.
Hi, I'm Kelly Henry. My zip code is 89011. I speak on behalf of a lot of people that live in Lake Las Vegas. Our concerns on this development is, if you read the Senate report, the Senate recommended to sell this land because it was too costly for the federal government to remediate it. Seems to us like, if it's too costly for the federal government, how can the taxpayers of this city and Clark County take it on? If it's done properly, the remediation. I think it was estimated in 2010 at $13 million to remediate that land properly. It might have been billion. Sorry, I don't have that figure. But that's our concern, is if the federal government can't afford it, how can we, as the taxpayers? I feel like our taxes are going to go up incredibly because of this development. Our other concerns are, there are three major concerns about this development. First, about the health of it. I attended another city-county meeting where a doctor from the VA, an oncology doctor from the VA, came to discuss this land and the development of it, and he basically said, likened it to awakening a sleeping bear. He said we would likely see at least 20% increase in cancer in people in a surrounding area. It extended beyond Lake Las Vegas, but he estimated a 20% increase in cancer diagnoses. And then the third concern is traffic. If you've been out to Lake Las Vegas in the morning or in the afternoon during heavy traffic times, you should see how long it takes to get from Lake Las Vegas to the interstate. There's only two ways out there, two roads currently. One is Galleria and one is Lake Mead Parkway. Those are, takes a long time to get just from two roads. So between the health concerns, between the increased taxes, and between the traffic that is going to be imposed on the city for additional traffic needs, we do not even support this development. Not to mention the increased liability. I understand that the city and the county will have additional taxes. However, there's also going to be additional liability from the additional cancer diagnoses that are going to be saying this was not recommended to be developed a land in the first place, and there's potential lawsuit and liability to the city and the county around that. So while they're thinking about monuments for World War II, they may want to consider some monuments for the future people that are going to lose their lives if this isn't developed properly.
Okay, thank you. Maybe we can get, do we have any other members of the audience who wishes to speak on this item, and then we'll let the applicant address the issues. Are there any other people in the audience who wish to speak on this? Seeing none, we'll go ahead and close the public hearing, and we'll go ahead and have our applicant address this. One thing I do need to clarify is we're here solely to discuss land use and not the cleanup. The cleanup is not our purview. It's the purview of NDEP and probably the federal government and other people that I'm sure they'll share with us. But that's not part of the Planning Commission's purview. We're purely talking about the land use plan, the layout, the site plan, what might or might not be built there, but we are not able to deal with the other issues. But go ahead, applicant.
Yep, thank you. There's just a couple of things that that need to be stressed here. First, this is an open mine site that exists and is out there today. It needs to be cleaned up. The process for doing that was established in concert with the federal government, who adopted legislation in 2014. To provide for the ultimate cleanup and development of this site, followed up 2 years later by the Nevada legislature, and then ultimately by the city of Henderson. So we're here to fix a problem. And the way that you fix a problem is, and she's right, it costs a lot of money to clean this up and to remediate it. That's what the development is for. But one thing that needs to be corrected is this is not a general taxpayer obligation. The money that comes from cleaning, the money that will be provided to clean this up is most importantly initially being put forward by Pulte, solely by them, to begin the cleanup efforts. They will be reimbursed by tax increment that is created from the development of the project. So the people that are moving into that community are the ones ultimately paying for it. And so that it would not be correct to say that this is some sort of an obligation that will fall on the city as a whole. Your redevelopment agency created a redevelopment district for the express purpose of accomplishing this task. And that is what we are here to do, is to fulfill that. I'll use the word requirement because in our minds, it is a requirement of the United States Congress and the state of Nevada. So we are here for that purpose. The other thing I would state, and hopefully maybe the fact that there isn't a room full of people like John and I would typically expect on a project like this, the amount of outreach and discussion that has happened in particular with the Lake Las Vegas community is immense, not just from our efforts as the developers, but from most importantly from the Nevada Department of Environmental Protection, who has hosted numerous outreach meetings and forums to get the word out and to explain how this is going to be cleaned up and to provide as much information as possible. There's a website that they have created that explains in painstaking detail for those interested how this is going to be done. So this is a overseen, permitted effort by NDEP. There is a plan that we have provided to them that they have approved that we have to follow. And so it's important to note that. The Lake Las Vegas Master Association has been briefed on this ad nauseum, and they're in support of obviously cleaning up the mine, most importantly, and of the ultimate project. We end up, in particular, along with the city and us, spent time with Lake Las Vegas Presidents Association, which is basically all of the presidents of each HOA in Lake Las Vegas. We made presentations to them. John was there. He can speak that if you have questions for him. The amount of information that was provided and the questions that were asked, we were there for many hours responding to them to make sure that they were comfortable and that they understood how and when this was going to happen. So this isn't something that has just all of a sudden popped up on everyone's radar. This is the culmination of a lot of effort and time by the city of Henderson, by NDEP and by us to make sure that everybody understands what we're doing here. And I would hope that by the turnout today, that maybe we've done a pretty good job with that. So I don't think I have anything else. The only thing I would add on the traffic is we have an approved traffic study. So the traffic alignments that Andy laid out for you, most notably the East-West Parkway and the three ways to access the community off of Lake Mead, have been studied, assessed, and approved by the City of Henderson traffic folks. That's it. Do you have any other questions for me?
Yes. Congress passed the Three Kids Mind Act, which was the remediation and reclamation, correct?
Correct.
And this entire project, the way I've heard it, read it, is being monitored by NDEP. Is that correct? Could you tell the people here what NDEP stands for?
Sorry, that the NDEP is the Nevada Department of Environmental Protection. Okay. So they are the state agency that is in charge of, you know, environmental protection for the state, and they are the ones that were charged to to oversee, permit the remediation and reclamation efforts. And so that process has been ongoing. We are, you know, kind of in the final stretch with them. They have done all of their required public outreach, and they're ready to go, which is why we're here before you now. So
another comment. I've lived here since 1949. I too, of course, have been concerned about the mine, but more so if something's not done. Something has to be done, because sooner or later somebody is going to do something, and all we can do is hope for that it's being monitored the way it is being monitored here, not just by you, but by the City of Henderson and by the government as a whole. That congressional act, and that's titled the Three Kids Mind. That's not just a general kind of congressional act. It's titled the Three Kids Mind. So I believe this is going to get a lot of attention. They're not going to let this pass. And are you guys going to be giving us little progress reports occasionally?
We have reporting requirements in the development agreement, right, where we have to provide, we have to provide updates to council on the status of the, on how the project is proceeding in the development agreement. That's part of the development agreement requirement.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Just for clarification, the NDEP is monitoring the process. They're not paying for the process.
Correct.
They don't seem like they cough up a lot of money, but just for clarification.
Gentleman over here, his company is paying for the cleanup of this.
So they're just monitoring, and the state's not paying.
Yeah, they are a regulatory agency, so their job is to make sure it is being done correctly and safely.
And so ultimately the reimbursement of the cost will be the home buyers, potentially, if this got approved by in the community.
Correct.
The new community that would live in this area.
Yeah, and that happens through the city's redevelopment agency.
It's like an SID or an LID or.
And that is not similar. That is a very common practice, as you know, for Cadence, for Lake Las Vegas. Even they've got a variety of tax increment projects out there, so that's not an uncommon way for these things to be funded, as you guys know. So,
no, thank you.
My comment. I had a question, Tom. It's going back to the traffic study. Is there streetlights that are going to be added to Lake Mead Parkway, or what is going to be added for ingress and egress into the community? Because that wasn't addressed in this, and we've talked about that before. I'm just
right
for further clarification.
So. You want to talk about it?
Yeah, I don't remember.
Go ahead.
I'll do my best, Chair, Commissioner. I know that there's a traffic signal planned at Lake Mead Parkway and Lake Las Vegas, and then a future signal planned further to the west, and that would be when it's warranted. So there is traffic control. There are turn lanes in the approved TIA that we work very closely with the City of Henderson traffic folks on. Specifically, there's a double left coming out of Center Parkway to go westbound, and then obviously D-cell lanes coming in. So it's pretty extensive. We didn't come prepared necessarily to answer all those very detailed questions, but we could probably ask and get more clarity if necessary.
Yeah. The only thing I would add to that is, you know, where the entry drives for our project popped out on Lake Mead was something that was important to the city, obviously, and making sure that our primary entrance or one of our primary entrances did line up with Lake Las Vegas Parkway. Right. So you don't want to have a bunch of obviously offset intersections along a street like Lake Mead, right? So lining those up were important. You know, East-West Parkway runs parallel to Lake Mead, and that will, you know, that will ultimately be accessed by a future, I mean, I'll call it foothills because I think that's what the city refers to it. A foothills comes all the way through from the south and connects to Lake Mead. We would be accessing, you know, East-West Parkway can be accessed off of that road as well. And there could potentially be a signal that would be the other signal Andy was referring to, which would be further to the west. But the other two access points wouldn't be signaled. So.
Dave, you have any questions?
No, I just have one more question.
Sure.
Will you, is the intention to use some of the hills, probably what, south, kind of southeast there to do some of the backfill?
Yeah, so I can just kind of give you a general overview on that. So the amount of property that was provided by the federal government to accomplish the task did include a lot of those areas where we are intended to utilize that rock, that material to aid in the remediation, and most Andy can point it out to me here, but
yeah,
this would be the primary area where that would come from. Where he's pointing
is now on screen.
There we go. So we were, you know, we were part that extra acreage was essentially given so that we would have enough material to essentially, you know, fill in the holes, you know, I mean, for lack of a better way of saying it, which is what we're doing. I mean, the manganese tailings will go into the holes that are out there, and then it will be covered up ultimately with 10 feet of clean fill over those specific sites. So, and it'll come from both of those areas of the project. So we've been given everything that we need to complete the remediation totally on site, which is important because that keeps us from hauling material in and out. Everything is designed to be done and completely done within the project, which is important for everyone.
Right, not transporting all that dirt.
Correct.
In and out of there, that's a pretty deep hole.
It is.
Yeah, yes. To say the least, right. Okay, thank you.
All right. Any other questions?
No further questions.
All right.
The only other thing I think I would just want to make sure is that there's been so much time that has been put in by so many people, by Nick and Bethany and Sally at the city attorney's office, and by Lisa and Eddie and Brian and Andrew and her staff, and Anthony Malloy in redevelopment, and Sean Robertson in redevelopment. It's just this has been a massive undertaking by the city to put these documents together. Brian and Andy spent hours and hours and hours to put these development standards together. So it's really rewarding kind of to be here after, especially probably for Mindy more so than anybody, after all these years to finally be presenting it to you. So it was just a tremendous effort by the city as a whole to get us to this point. So we just want to let you know how grateful we are to have gotten to this point with you guys. So thank you.
Tom, I would just say it's very exciting for Henderson as a Henderson resident and longtime resident to see an exciting new master plan come to fruition in a time where we're designing better places. A lot of times people don't understand the value of design until it's already here. And so to have the, you know, him to come from Arizona, explain some of the thoughts behind that design. Like, you know, we talked in previous meetings, like having areas that are actually not just aesthetic, but are also functional to our way of lifestyle here in Southern Nevada, I think is very crucial. So we really appreciate all of your efforts that you put together.
We appreciate that, Commissioner. Thank you.
And thank you. And I would be very pleased and honored to make a motion.
All right, Commissioner,
to approve.
Ask us.
Yeah. Where's that? I can't read it.
Yeah, it's
see.
Yes,
it's cut off.
Can we read it for her?
Yeah, if you want to read it. For some reason, mine's cut off.
Yeah, also. Rebecca Grisk-Menaske, Miss.
We'll work on that part.
is making an approval of DEV 20220118-74.
Subject to findings of fact and condition.
Yeah, mine's was cut off as well. Subject to findings of condition.
That's the missing component.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, there's a motion on the floor. Please vote. And then we have the zone change. For some reason, it's all cut off.
It approved.
That motion was approved. Now for the zone change, ZCA.
Okay. I think I might be able to get this one. Motion to approve DEV 20220118-74, subject to findings of fact and condition.
Might be
20220118-72, subject to findings of fact. Sorry, it's can't read it.
A little technical difficulty. There's a motion on the floor for that to approve the zone change.
Okay.
Please vote. And then the for the tentative.
Okay, then the final TMA 20220118-73, subject to conditions, motion to approve.
And that motion passes.
Great, thank you guys very much, appreciate it.
The project. We can invite Steve to join us again.
All right, item number 10 is for Lake Mead Starbucks. This is a two-part request, including a conditional use permit and a design review for a new restaurant with drive-through facility on 0.7 acres located at 390 West Lake Mead Parkway in the Lake Mead Crossing Shopping Center. The proposed drive-through facility is compatible with adjacent non-residential uses and complies with all standards for a drive-through facility. The applicant has demonstrated that adequate parking and stacking spaces will be provided on-site. Further, the existing above-grade walls, berming, and landscaping along Lake Mead Parkway will adequately screen the drive-through lane. Staff recommends approval of this request.
All right, before we hear this item, I need a quick disclosure. Ms. Olson, the applicant's attorney and representative on this item, is also an attorney for my employer, Lewis Management Corp, and she's currently assisting me in issues related to a project in North Las Vegas. That project is not related to this item, and I don't believe her assistance on that project will materially affect my judgment in considering this item. And I don't believe that it would affect the judgment of a reasonable person in my situation. I have been advised by counsel to make the disclosure pursuant to Nevada ethics laws, but that I do not need to abstain from this matter.
Good evening, Liz Olson, 1980 Festival Plaza Drive, here on behalf of the applicant. We appreciate staff's recommendation and concur with all of the conditions. Just one note that was discussed in briefings, we are providing a queuing lane of up to 16 cars. Typically, the concern with Starbucks is that queuing lane. So we are providing queuing all the way around the building. So happy to answer any questions.
All right, we'll go ahead and open the meeting to the public. Is there anyone in the audience who wishes to speak on this item? Seeing none, we'll go ahead and close the public hearing. Commissioners, questions, concerns, coffee? No? Any motion?
I will move for approval.
Go for it,
Steve. I'll move for approval of CUP 20230129-55. Subject to findings of fact and conditions.
All right, there's a motion. Please vote. That motion passes. Second part.
And I will move for approval of DRA 2023-012963, subject to conditions.
That motion passes. Congratulations.
Thank you. Have a good night.
Item number 11 is for Luxme Plaza Liquor Store. This is a request for a new liquor store with a modification to reduce the minimum distance separation from a Category 1 liquor use to a school at 5799 East Russell Road. The applicant is requesting to reduce the required distance from 1,000 feet to 927 feet, which is a 7% reduction. The proposed use is compatible with existing uses as there is currently an approved tavern at the site, which is a Category 1 liquor use. The existing grade along Stephanie Place will also provide an adequate buffer to the school. The applicant has demonstrated that the liquor store will comply with all applicable standards and approval criteria. Staff recommends approval of this request.
Hi, name and zip code for the record, please.
Hello, Simona Stevens, 89011. I'm on behalf on the applicant, and we did review the conditions, and we are good to go with them. Approve it.
Thank you. Is there anyone in the audience on this item? I'll open the public hearing. Seeing none, we'll go ahead and close the public hearing. Commissioners?
Just a comment that the percent of the footage that you're asking for versus the required by ordinance is reasonable. I mean, you're not asking for half or something like that because it is a school involved. Mm-hmm. And so I appreciate it.
Thank you.
So, make a motion to approve. Oh, wait, anybody else
have questions? Anyone else have comments?
I don't know if I'm reading this right, but a motion to approve CUP 2023012884, subject to findings of facts and condition.
Motion on the floor, please vote. And that motion passes. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Item number 12 is for Eternal Trends Customs. This is a request for vehicle repair use for a window tinting business at 738 West Sunset Road. The applicant has demonstrated that adequate parking will be provided and the proposed use is compatible with the adjacent uses on the site. Staff recommends approval of this request.
All right. Name and zip code for the record, please.
Eric Nosker, 89011.
All right. Do you have a presentation, or have you reviewed staff's recommendations?
Yeah, we feel that the location we are at is consistent with the area along Sunset and Middle Gate where we're located. Any questions? I'd be happy to answer.
Thank you. Is there anyone in the audience who wishes to speak on this item? I'll open the public hearing. Seeing none, we'll go ahead and close the public hearing. Commissioners, any questions, concerns?
Any samples? Did you bring any samples with you today so that we could see your work?
You can come to the shop. I'd be happy to help you out.
No further questions?
No questions.
I'll make an approval for CUP 2023-012973, subject to findings of fact and conditions.
There's a motion on the floor. Please vote. That motion passes. Congratulations. Good luck with your project.
Item number 13 is for Cipriana Villas. This is a waiver request to reduce hillside standards for a residential development on 15.8 acres, generally located between Viento Puntero Drive and West Ridge Drive, approximately 1,310 feet south of Horizon Ridge Parkway. The request includes increasing the maximum height of vertical fill from 35 feet to 55 feet, decreasing the minimum vertical street curve from 100 feet to 80 feet, reducing the minimum cul-de-sac radius from 45 feet to 40 and a half feet, increasing the height of the vertical masonry retaining wall from 6 feet to 20 feet, and increasing the total maximum retaining wall height from 36 feet to 40 feet. The applicant has provided adequate compensating benefits for these requests. Staff notes that the same request was previously approved but expired in June of 2021. The date of expiration for this application will coincide with the approved tentative map at this location. Staff recommends approval of this request.
All right, applicant, name and zip code for the record.
Good evening, Chris Malandrino, 89074.
Perfect.
This particular project was previously approved. The situation we had was merely COVID-based funding issues. So we resubmitted it with virtually no changes, and we thank the commission for reviewing it.
Thank you. I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone in the audience who wishes to speak on this? Seeing none, we'll go ahead and close the public hearing and turn it over to the commissioners.
Make a motion. I'll make a motion to approve the WOS 202-301 2972, subject to finding and facts.
Conditions and waivers.
I have a motion on the floor, subject to findings of facts, conditions, and waivers. And that motion passes.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Congratulations, and have a good evening.
Item number 14 is for Wes Henderson Hospital. This is a request for a master sign plan for a 300,000 square foot hospital building on 39.4 acres located at St. Rose Parkway and Raiders Way. The applicant is requesting a total of 5 modifications. The first is to allow wall signage along the west elevation where no wall signs are currently allowed. The second is to increase the total allowed square footage of overall wall signage from 100 square feet to 1,841 square feet. The third is to increase the total number of allowed directory signs from 6 to 14. The fourth is to increase the total allowed height of 2 monument signs from 6 feet to 13 feet and 1 monument sign from 6 to 8 feet. And the fifth is to increase the allowed square footage for 2 monument signs from 300 square feet to 308 square feet. Staff notes that the applicant has worked with staff to decrease the amount of proposed signage on the building. The applicant has demonstrated that the proposed signage will be compatible with the existing architecture in site and that there is a need for increased signage on site due to the characteristics of the hospital use. Further, staff finds that the current sign standards for the PS zoning district are not intended for this type of intensive use, which necessitates the multiple modification requests. Staff recommends approval of this request.
All right, applicant, name and zip code for the record.
Thank you, Madam Chair, Commissioners. Tom Amick, 1980 Festival Plaza. I'm here on behalf of the applicant for this, which is UHS, for their new West Henderson Hospital master sign plan. So as you guys know, if you've been by there, this building is flying out of the ground. It's well into construction. You can see it out there when you go by at the intersection of St. Rose and Raiders Way. So this is the master sign plan. As Erica pointed out, I mean, it sounds like a lot when you read it because your PS zoning district does not really supply the types of standards for a public use like this. A hospital, the most of your sign codes based around retail and commercial uses. So they have to write it up that way where it looks like there's a lot to it, but this is pretty standard. Mostly wayfinding signage for a hospital. You know, you've got an emergency room here, and that needs to always be very clearly delineated out. So, last thing, this is very, very similar to what you see at the Henderson Hospital over in Union Village. I mean, it would be very, very similar sign package to what they use over there. So, can answer any other questions if you have them.
All right, thank you. I'll go ahead and open the public hearing. Is anyone in the audience wishing to speak on this item? Seeing none, we'll go ahead and close the public hearing. I will kind of make the comment to me is for hospitals, to me, there's almost no such thing as too much signage. You're potentially on the worst day of your life trying to find a location, and I've had that experience of trying to find an emergency room in a hospital that wasn't well marked. So
I have a strong bias towards making it as easy as possible on what potentially is maybe a terrible day, making it a little bit easier on your visitors. So that's my commentary, but I don't know if others have comments.
I'll move for approval of MSP 2023-011977, subject to conditions and modifications.
There's a motion on the floor from Commissioner Rice. Please vote. And that motion passes.
Great. Thank you very much.
Congratulations.
Item number 15 is for Green Valley Crossing. This item is a request to amend the approved master sign plan with a modification to increase the maximum wall sign area from 4,050 square feet to 4,118 square feet for a commercial center located at 725 South Green Valley Parkway in Unit 150. This request would accommodate a new 68 square foot sign along the south elevation of the tenant space, while signage is allowed along each elevation for the corner tenant space. This request includes signs that are larger than the other signs that have been approved within the commercial center. If the applicant were to reduce the size of all three proposed wall signs, the signage would comply with the approved master sign plan. Further, the applicant has not demonstrated special circumstances or conditions that are unique to the tenant space that would not apply to, in general, to other businesses within the commercial center. Therefore, staff recommends denial of this request.
All right, is there an applicant on this item? Applicant? No applicant? If you're the applicant, you need to turn up really quickly here.
Takers, anybody? Takers?
I'm not seeing an applicant, and we already have a recommendation for denial, so I'm...
Well, since
makes it a little...
the applicant didn't show up, and he had no intentions of complying with the conditions set by the city, I make a motion to deny.
May I ask one question? We have staff is kind of has a comment. Have we heard from the applicant?
We reached out to them. I know we've been in discussions with them about this application as we are recommending denial. But my suggestion is maybe we trail this to the end and see if they show up, and then we could take action at that point. But again, you're free to take whatever action you'd like. I mean, our recommendation would be to continue it to a future meeting, but if you, again, that would be what staff would recommend, and you're free to take that advice or not.
But based on all of the conditions for the denial, there are a lot that this individual would not comply with, and I mean like 12, 13 issues, and this person would not comply on any of them. So I continue with the motion for denial.
And the meeting started at 4:00 and it's 5:15, and I'm prepared to vote now.
I'm prepared to vote.
I would have probably be more into giving him a month off personally, but if someone else has a motion.
I make a motion to deny MSP 2008-590015-A4.
Is that a yes?
Yeah, it's a yes for the denial.
Yeah. There's a motion to deny.
So yes is denial, correct?
Correct.
Correct.
Okay.
All right, moving on.
All right, item number 16 is for Volunteer and Via Inspirata. This is a request for a master sign plan with modifications for four monument signs to increase the height from 8 feet to 12 feet and increase the size from 64 square feet to 96 square feet on 63.2 acres, generally located at the southeast corner of Via Centro and Volunteer Boulevard. The proposed signage is compatible with the existing site and architecture. The applicant has agreed to limit the number of signs to a total of four monument signs at the site, which will result in less signage overall for the industrial development, as they are currently allowed to have a total of 10 monument signs. Staff recommends approval of this request.
All right, applicant name and zip code for the record.
Melissa Ure, EURE, 1055 Whitney Ranch Drive, 89014, here on behalf of the applicant. So As you can see here, we're showing the site plan. This is already an approved industrial project with about 1 million square feet of industrial space that's there between the four buildings. And what we're proposing is, as staff said, 4 of the monument signs versus the 10 that code will allow. We are asking for an increase in the size from 8 feet to 12 feet for those monument signs. And in addition, which requires us to require us that we increase the square footage from 64 to 96 square feet for each sign. So you can see in here, we do have one on Volunteer. We have one that's going to be located on Via Centro, and then 2 on Larson, where each of the entries are. These monument signs, this is a Dermody Properties project, and they do multiple industrial projects throughout the state. So this is their branded monument sign that they're using to for cohesiveness at all of their industrial properties. They have a nice brushed aluminum at the top. It's painted metal up here. And then at the bottom, they're going to have a nice faux stone facade that'll be compatible with the colors of the rest of the development. The sign itself is not illuminated, so there is no actual backlighting to the sign, and they are allowing with this increased size for co-location of tenant signage. So not only will they have their sign on there, but it will allow for the tenants to be on there. The hope is that one, this makes it a lot easier for trucks coming into the center to be able to locate where that tenant is within the site and create a little bit less cross access through the back of where the truck distribution areas are. In addition, there's quite a bit of wall signage. However, we're not doing the wall signs. Each tenant will be able to submit their design for their signage to the city for the city to review and approve as they come in. And with that, happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. I'll open the public hearing. Is anyone in the audience wishing to speak on this item? Seeing none, we'll go ahead and close the public hearing. Commissioners, how do you feel about this one?
Yes, it's refreshing to see less signs than more. Thank you. And we appreciate doing that. Is there any other comments or questions? I'll move to approve MSP 2023-013-119, subject to conditions and modifications.
And there's a motion on the floor. Please vote. And that motion passes.
Thank you.
Good luck. And that brings us to item 17.
Item number 17 is for Serene Country Estates, Sansone St. Rose Park. This is a 2-part request for a zone change and conditional use permit for a new restaurant with drive-through facility on a 0.7-acre portion of the overall Serene Country Estates planned unit development located at 2590 St. Rose Parkway. Staff notes that the proposed building will replace a former restaurant with drive-through. The proposed drive-through facility will be located on the south and west side of the site, farthest away from the neighboring residential properties, and will be screened by a 6-foot-tall decorative wall in addition to landscaping. The applicant has demonstrated that adequate parking and stacking spaces will be provided for the proposed use. This request complies with all development code standards, including the Rural Neighborhood Protection Standards. Staff recommends approval of this request and notes that a memorandum accompanies this item. This item will be scheduled for the October 3rd City Council meeting.
All right, applicant, name and zip code for the record.
Brandon Epperson, 85379. And yeah, as she mentioned, we're a drive-through restaurant. We serve salads, same use that is currently there, drive-through, and we are in compliance with all codes. So here to answer any questions.
Thank you. Is there anyone in the audience who wishes to speak on this item? There's not very many people left in the audience. Seeing none, we'll go ahead and close the public hearing. Wait, no one for this one? All right, we'll go ahead and close this item, the public hearing, and turn it over to the commissioners.
Look forward to sampling salad on the go. So
look forward to having you there.
I'll make a motion to approve CZO 2005-670056-A4, subject to findings of fact, conditions, and waivers.
Motion on the floor, please vote. And that motion passes. Congratulations on your salad.
Thank
Thanks so much.
Item number 18 is for Green Valley Evangelical Lutheran Church. This is a two-part request for an existing religious assembly and daycare facility located at 1799.
Oh, wait.
I think we missed the
CUP. The CUP is missing.
Oh, oops.
You want to make a motion?
Wait.
I'll make a motion to approve CUP 2023-013-120, subject to findings of fact, conditions, and waivers.
And that motion passes. Sorry about that. We got a little excited. All right, now we can go again on our...
Okay. Item number 18 is for Green Valley Evangelical Lutheran Church. This is a two-part request for an existing religious assembly and daycare facility located at 1799 Wigwam Parkway. The first part includes a conditional use permit to add a school with a maximum of 132 students as an accessory use to the existing religious assembly. The second part is to add a modular classroom within the southeast end of the parking lot as a temporary solution until a permanent classroom addition can be built in front of the existing daycare building. The applicant has demonstrated that adequate parking is still provided on site and the proposed use will be compatible with the existing uses on the site. Staff recommends approval of this request.
All right, applicant, name and zip code for the record.
Hi, Kevin Thistle, 89179. I'm the architect here on behalf of the owner. Just wanted to say that we concur with staff's recommendations and we appreciate the assistance with staff in processing this application.
Thank you. Is there anyone in this audience who wishes to speak on this item? Seeing none, we'll go ahead and close the public hearing and commissioners.
I will move for approval of CUP 2023-013233, subject to findings of fact and conditions.
A motion on the floor, please vote.
Thank you very much.
Wait, we've got one more. Is there a motion on the design review?
As soon as it comes up.
I'm not going to mess up your talk.
Well, I will move for approval of DRA 2013-500089-A1, subject to conditions.
Motion on the floor, please vote. And that motion passes as well.
Item number 19 is for Casa del Sol Land Use and Zoning. The City of Henderson is initiating a comprehensive plan amendment and zone change on a portion of a 43.2-acre property generally located southeast of Las Vegas Boulevard and Larson Lane. The land use amendment includes a change on 16 acres from public/semi-public to neighborhood type 4 to be consistent with the rest of the site. The rezoning includes applying high-density residential zoning on 20 acres of property with currently no established zoning. This is the first step in the eventual conveyance of future development for the site. The request aligns with the surrounding and adjacent residential properties and high-density uses within the area. Staff recommends approval of this request. This item will be scheduled for the October 3rd City Council meeting.
Are you the applicant?
Yes, staff will.
Okay, so we're acting as both the speaker and the applicant. Yes. Fair enough.
All three of us are happy to answer any questions you may have.
So. All right. Is there anyone in the audience who wishes to speak on this item? Come on down. And name and zip for the record, please.
Vicki Davis. My family's at 89044. I personally reside in Phoenix. I came in today to listen. My family has 20-plus acres of property right there on Larson Lane and Las Vegas Boulevard. So this is right next door. I'm curious. I notice in here it's designated that there is already high-density uses and developments adjacent to that area. And being out there for 30 years, I'm really kind of curious what it is that is currently out there that is high density uses. I'm out there every day, all day, and there's not much out there. So I feel like this is kind of, it's not accurate information, number one. And number two, it seems to me that they are, the city of Henderson is buying this based on only if they can get it rezoned. High density, it's right on Las Vegas Boulevard. High density right on Las Vegas Boulevard when hotel casinos are starting to come south. Doesn't seem like a real wise plan. The M's about to build up another tower. There is a station casino coming out and possibly more coming out there. So a high density residential doesn't make a lot of sense to somebody who's been out there for 30 years. Keeping it both, zoned both, seems like an appropriate action in my personal opinion. And that's just coming from somebody whose family's been out there for 30 years. So just thought I'd share that with you guys.
All right. Is there anyone else in the audience who wishes to speak on this item? Seeing none, maybe we can have the staff address the questions and concerns here.
Sure. Just for the record, Andrew Rother, planning manager with Community Development Services here in the City of Henderson. In the staff report, it does refer to some high-density uses. As you may recall, we have approved a couple of high-density apartment projects here within the proximity, a general proximity of this area, but we're also speaking to the existing land use plan for this area. The lady is correct that Las Vegas Boulevard is typically reserved for some higher density residential development, and so there is existing land use in place that would allow for that type of development. This site, which is owned by the BLM, doesn't have that designation. It kind of has a split designation, if you will, in our land use plan, and so now we're just trying to change the land use plan to accommodate future sale of the site that would allow for that type of development. So we look at this corridor along Las Vegas Boulevard as being something to allow for higher densities. We've already seen some approvals on projects like this a little further south, and so this is just a continuation of that.
All right. I think we've closed the public hearing.
Oh, okay.
So I don't know, is there other questions of staff? Commissioners, any comments, questions?
Andy, is this part of like the affordable housing that's been proposed?
At this point, it's not necessarily, there's not a current buyer of any sort. It's just it's preparing it for a future sale. So it's probably too preliminary to speak to exactly the type of development that it would be. It's just more putting it in place. As you may know, we've been working with the Bureau of Land Management for a roundabout in this area. So the kind of the traffic patterns in this area are going to change. There's some development of schools with CCSD that are going to happen here in the next few years as well. And so we're just preparing this site for a future sale, whether who the end up buyer ends up being is something that I don't think we've kind of hashed out yet.
So essentially, though, you're just trying to remove the public. Like right now with the PS, it's land use plan for.
That's correct. And when we established the land use plan, and I believe in 2014, some of the site was reserved for a public facility type use. And those uses, as you know, kind of shift throughout time. So the need for maybe a police or a fire station or a public park or some sort of drainage facility. When the land use plan was drafted about 10 years ago, that's how portion of the site was identified. And so this would be kind of changing that. It's the location of public facilities in West Henderson and really anywhere in the city of Henderson is it's kind of fluid as the areas develop. And so that's why we're proposing to remove the PS zoning portion or the PS land use portion of that, because the need for the public facility that was originally identified has since moved on.
All right, thank you.
Can't we make a motion to allow her to speak again?
I think we could. What I think, since this is kind of a land use plan, I think we could probably go ahead and take a vote and then suggest that she and staff work together between now and then this should go to council. Because I think maybe it's more of a misunderstanding, but I don't know if I want to be the judge of that part, but I think...
Commissioner Lewis, this will be going to the October 3rd City Council meeting as well, and between now and that time, we'd be able to.
I would be, yeah, I think that would be.
And then there would be another public hearing.
Okay, because I think it's probably more of a clarification.
Will you be able to do that?
Yes.
Okay, perfect.
Thank you. And just to further clarify one more point, is that the public facility that this was originally identified for was going to be a high school site, and so the high school site has moved to a different location, and so the PS land use is no longer what we see as appropriate because it's very limiting as to what it allows. And since the school district we're no longer looking at a high school in this area, it seems appropriate to kind of remove the public facility land use category.
That seems like a high school on Las Vegas Boulevard's kind of a wonky and an unusual choice. We'll go with that. But all right, is there anyone who wants to
just the further comment to the young lady that you would be able to go to the city council and voice your opinion?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And I think it would probably work with staff. I'm sure staff will give you their information.
Absolutely.
Just trade and discuss.
I'll make a motion to approve CPA 2023-01-3182, subject to a finding of fact.
Is that motion on the floor? Please vote. And that motion passes. And there's also a...
I'll make a motion for approval of CZA 2023-01-3181, subject to findings of fact and conditions.
Motion on the floor, please vote. And that motion passes. And then I think that now I think that's our last one. So go ahead and open the floor up for public comment. Is there anyone in the audience who wishes to speak on under public comment? We cannot act on those items, but is there anyone who wishes to address the commission? Seeing none, I guess we'll close the public comment. And we want to make sure everyone has their chance to talk. Staff, do you guys have any comments?
Just thank you for your time.
Staff, any more comments?
No, thank you.
I'll go ahead and make my comments. Thank you to staff. Thank you to security. Thank you to our public works and our other guys, parks back there, who've hung out quietly in the back. Thank you to IT for keeping us working. And we'll see everyone next month. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Oh, I got to stretch. I'm not as limber as Dave.